And this was based on work with Karim, but some of the earlier work already appeared in the paper with also Jordi de Vries and Jorin van der Vis. And so before coming to the effective field theory part, let me first introduce the electroweak phase transition. And to put it into the broadest perspective, here's an overview of the timeline of the universe. And for most of the history of the universe, it was expanding adiabatically and nothing much was happening. But most, basically all of the interesting physics happens during these short periods where thermal equilibrium was lost and sudden changes happened. For example, unfortunately I cannot point with the mouse, but yeah, the period of recombination where atoms and electrons combined, the universe became transverse and the photons escaped. And these are the CMB photons of the cosmic microwave background that we see today. If you go a bit earlier, you have the periods of nuclear centrosis where the light elements were formed. And also these we can see traces of this period today because we can just see the amounts of light elements that we have. If you go back further in the universe at earlier times, we have a possible range of phase transition. And within the standard model, that's the QCD phase transition. And a bit earlier, at approximately a nanosecond after the Big Bang, you had the electroweak phase transition. And this happened when the temperature was of the electroweak scales around 10 GeV. And also here it goes, if this phase transition was sufficiently out of equilibrium, we might see still traces of it in today's universe, which would be interesting because it gets in another probe to see what happened and probe the physics of this transition and the dynamics. So to see what the phase transition looks like, this is of course the well-known Higgs potential at zero temperature. And just for the notation during this talk, for the Higgs doublet, I will use the letter phi. Whereas for the expectation value, so the classical field value, I will use H throughout this talk. So this is the temperature, the potential at zero temperature, but of course, and at three level, but of course there are quantum corrections as well. And if you calculate these corrections, if you look at the one loop correction, they correspond to all the bubble diagrams. And I've shown here one, just a loop with a top quark running in the loop. And if you calculate this in the early universe, you do it within the plasma of particles. So you have a background of a plasma at finite temperature. And the effect of that is that the virtual particles, they can exchange energy momenta with the plasma. And as a result, the one loop correction becomes temperature dependent. And in fact, it splits up in two pieces. One is the same piece that you have at zero temperature, the well-known Coleman-Weinberg one-loop corrections. And then you have a temperature-dependent piece called Vt here. And so this is some integral expression, but you can expand it at high temperatures. And the expansion is given at the bottom of the slide. So you have the first term in the Taylor expansion is the T to the fourth term. So this is just a contribution to the free energy. It will shift the overall scale of the potential, but it doesn't affect the dynamics. If you go to next order, you see that you get a quadratic term in the X field that scales with the temperature squared. And the coefficients here in this Taylor expansion, so the little a and b, they just depend on the degrees of freedom that you have in the plasma that are running in the loop. And in particular for this B coefficients of the coupling to the X field. So if you would calculate it within the standard model, it will depend on the Yukawa couplings, the X coupling and the X self coupling. But the main point here is that you see that you get a correction to the mass. And at large temperature, this positive correction will dominate over the three level negative Higgs mass that you have in the potential. So at large temperatures, the origin of the minimum of the potential is at the origin, whereas at low temperatures, as we just saw, you have the minimum at finite Higgs-Weff. So the question is, how do you get from high to low temperature, and how does this transition from zero Weff to finite Weff take place? And there are basically two possibilities, that the phase transition is of first order or second order or crossover type. And so the what actually happens depends on the next, well, to first approximation on the next term in this Taylor expansion, which is cubic in the Higgs field. And if at the critical temperature TC, this is the temperature that the two minima at the origin at finite Higgs field, they are degenerate. If there is no barrier, then the cross-section is, sorry, the phase transition is a crossover or second order. And if this happens, basically what happens is as the second minimum at lower temperatures goes lower and lower, the field just slowly rolls from the origin to finite Weff. And this is all happening quite close to thermal equilibrium, and not much interesting is happening. So the interesting case is actually the first order phase transition. And this is the case when at the critical temperature, there's a barrier between the two minima as shown on the plot on the left. And if this is the case, you can only go transition to the new phakia via tunneling. And what happens in practice is that you form small bubbles of this new phakium, and these then expand and take over all of space eventually, and that finishes the phase transition. And this is clearly, or can clearly be a very out of equilibrium process, so which is interesting for cosmology. As I said, the coefficients of this Taylor expansion, so the shape of the effective potential and how it changes with temperature, you can just calculate given your theory. And within the standard model, it turns out that you have a second order, or actually crossover phase transition for Higgs masses that are larger than approximately 65 GeV. So the measured Higgs mass is 125 GeV. So we're clearly in the regime of a crossover. As I'm more interested in the case of a first order, this means that yeah, it can still happen, but you need new physics. And this is what I will assume during this talk. So one question you can ask is still, so you need new physics, and the new physics must affect the Higgs potential, so you want new physics coupling to the Higgs. And you may ask how much is still possible given the data we have on the Higgs, how much can you still change the Higgs potential? And of course, what we have measured by now is the Higgs mass, which is about 125 GeV, and the expectation value of the Higgs in the minimum, 246 GeV. And this means that you know the position of the minimum that's given by the Weff, and you know the curvature around this minimum, which is given by the Higgs mass. But further away from this minimum, we have no real constraining data yet. So I've here plotted two possible Higgs potential, and both are at the moment still consistent with the data. So there's still quite a bit of room to for new physics and to change the Higgs potential and to get a first order phase transition. And if you would actually want to further constrain the Higgs potential, you would have to measure the trilinear or quartic Higgs self interactions. But this is really hard to do. And for example, the reason is just that the cross sections for these kind of processes that's relevant, for example, to measure the trilinear Higgs interaction, the cross sections are just really, really small. And for example, you can define this kappa 3 parameter, which is the trilinear Higgs coupling, normalized by the value it would have in the standard model. And at the moment, this is still poorly constrained. So kappa 3 can still range between minus 1 and something like the order of 7. With the next high luminosity upgrade of DLHC, you can do much better, but not that much better. Basically, you can constrain this kappa parameter to order one precision. And if you want to do better, you have to go to future colliders. But even then, it's really hard. And for example, only something like 10% precision can be reached in the FCC, so the Circular Hadronic Collider, or in CLIC, proposed electron collider. But both this high precision only in the basically the most energetic phase, the most expensive version of the collider. So it's the main message is it's really hard with collider physics to further constrain the Higgs potential. So it would be, it is great if cosmology offers a different way of probing the physics of the Higgs potential in the phase transition. And as I've argued, this can happen if the phase transition is first order, because the non-equilibrium dynamics gives leads to processes that leave traces in today's universe. And one of the examples of such a trace is that you can get a spectrum of gravitational waves. Because if the phase transition is first order, as I said, it goes via the emission, the creation of bubbles, and these bubbles can collide, and also these bubbles, as they expand, they will lead to waves in the plasma that can collide. You can have turbulence as well, and all these three processes can give rise to a spectrum of gravitational waves. And what's the nice thing as well is that, so the typical frequency or the peak frequency of the spectrum will be set just by the scale of where it is happening, so the Hubble scale at the time of the phase transition. And if you then redshift it to today's universe, it turns out that the peak frequency is right in the range of what LISA, the sensitivity of the upcoming LISA experiment. So if this spectrum of gravitational waves is large enough, you might be able to measure it in the near future. A second possible consequence of the phase transition is that the asymmetry between matter and antimatter in our universe can be generated during this phase transition. And here the idea is that if you have additional sources of CP violation, then particles and antiparticles will scatter differently of those expanding bubbles. And this asymmetry can then be transferred in a baryon asymmetry by the non-perturbative electroweak Schwellhorn processes. A final example of a cosmological consequence is that magnetic fields may be generated during the phase transition. And an example is shown from a numerical simulation in this figure here, where the magnetic field is sourced by the gradient terms surrounding the bubble. So this sort of finishes the introduction on the electroweak phase transition. Let me then continue. So it would be great if this electroweak phase transition can be described in a model independent way, or at least a nearly model independent way, using effective field theory methods. And so the EFT that I'm interested in for this process is the standard model effective field theory, because the phase transition occurs at the temperatures of the electroweak scale. So this sets the scale of the process I'm interested in. And the degrees of freedom at these scales are the standard model degrees of freedom. So the assumption in this effective field theory is that whatever new physics there is, this is heavy and can be integrated out. It's heavier than the electroweak scale. The Lagrangian is then the standard model of Lagrangian plus a whole tower of higher order operators, and these operators take into account the effects of the new physics that has been integrated out. And as the only, the light degrees of freedom are the standard model of degrees of freedom, these operators, they consist of the standard model fields. And the lambda here is the scale of the new physics. And you can think of this as the mass of the new particles introduced. And the coefficient CI in this formula here, called the Wilson coefficients, and they sort of give the, they parameterize the strength of these new interactions. And the advantage of this approach is, well, first of all, it's simple in the context of the electroweak phase transition, where I'm interested in the Higgs dynamics. It means I only have to track about the Higgs field itself and not about the extra new physics, which is, I think, the main reason why it's quite often used in the literature to describe the phase transition. The other great advantage I also alluded already to is that it sort of provides, to some extent, a model-independent way to describe the phase transition. Because if I include all possible operators that are consistent with the symmetries, so the Cage symmetries and Lorentz symmetry, and then depending on choice, you can also add baryon number and symmetry as a global symmetry. Then this parameterizes all possible UV completions. And if you turn it around, if you have a given model that you wanna check, you can just integrate out new physics, match it onto the EFT Lagrangian, and see what the constraints that are derived in full generality imply for your particular model. And finally, this would still be useless if you had to take into account the full tower of higher dimensional operators, because here in this series, you have operators that have mass dimension 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, etc. And well, taking them out into account is impossible. But if the scale of high of new physics is large enough, so this lambda scale is large enough, it implies that if you look at higher and higher order dimensional operators, they're suppressed by more powers of this cutoff scale. And so at low energies, much below the cutoff scales, the effects of these new interactions are suppressed. So if you want to calculate some observable, depending on the precision that you want for your calculation, you can truncate this this power series at a given mass dimension. But this, as I mentioned, this really relies that there is a separation of scales between the scale of the process you're interested in our case, the electroweak phase transition, so the electroweak scale, and the scales of new physics, say the masses of the new particles involved. And this is the basically the main question that I'll be addressing during the rest of the talk. Is this really the case when you're trying to describe the electroweak phase transition? Do you have the necessary separation of scales? And so let me now apply this general framework to the phase transition itself. And so the first approximation, namely, if you only consider the tree level, the operators are of interest. The higher dimensional operators are the ones only involving the Higgs field. So I've written down here the dimension 6 operators, and there are 3 independent ones. The last one here is the 5 to the 6th operator. So this gives you a correction to your potential, or at least to the potential interactions. And then there are 2 additional operators that correct the kinetic terms. As it turns out, in the parameter space of interest for the phase transition, these corrections to the kinetic terms are subdominant. So for simplicity during this talk, I will leave them out in most formulas just to simplify the equations, but you can include them. And finally, I also included the most dominant, so the dimension 6 operator, which is the phi to the a term. So what you want to do, you want to look at the x potential itself. So you can, again, write it in terms of the expectation value, so the classical field value defined here, and then to get canonical kinetic terms for this field, you can do a field redefinition. And then the potential is of the form given at the bottom of the slide here, with you have the quadratic and quartic terms, but then the corrections from the new physics are the dimension 6 and the dimension 8 term. And the cutoff scale lambda, so you have two new parameters, and one of them is the cutoff scale lambda that sets the strength of this dimension 6 term. And then the C8 coefficient of the dimension 8 term sets the relative strength between the dimension 6 and 8 operators. And finally, the A2 and A4 coefficients, so the coefficients of the quadratic and quartic term, they're fixed, they can be fixed by the physical quantities. So you can replace them by the measured Higgs mass and the measured Higgs VEF. So if you do this, then the effective potential, including the one loop corrections up to dimension 6, is given by the expression at the bottom of the slide here. And you see that both the quadratic and the quartic term, they can flip sign depending of the size of the dimension 6 or the interactions of the cutoff scale lambda. And so for the three level potential to have sort of two minima, what you want is that the quadratic term is positive, then the quartic term is negative, and then the potential is stabilized by the dimension 6 term, so that it has the this shape with two minima. And for a first order phase transition, you want to be close to this point where you flip the signs of the dimension 2 and 4 terms, so that you're close to this point where you have this two minima, because then together with the perturbative one loop corrections, the effective potential at finite temperature can have the required form for a first order phase transition, where you have two minima with a barrier in between. So this is then a good estimate for when in this effective potential do you have a first order phase transition. That is when the parameters are such, so the lambda parameter, the cutoff scale is such that you're close to this sign flip. And this gives the estimate at the top of the slides that lambda square is of the order of 700 to 1000 GeV. So this is well above the electroweak scale of the phase transition, which is around 100 GeV, but it's still not comfortably above it that you can say that you surely have a separation of scales. So the second requirement for the use of the EFT description is that the dimension 8 term, now written again in the equation at the bottom, is small compared to the dimension 6 term during the phase transition, so at the energy scales of the phase transition. And also, which gives this second requirement. So it gives the C8 parameter cannot be too large. As these are estimates, we also did a numerical scan of the phase transition and when it's first order. And the results are shown in this plot over here. So wherever there is, when you see colors, you have a first order phase transition. And the color coding gives the strength of the phase transition, which is defined by the Higgs field you tunnel to, or basically the fields inside the bubble at the time of nucleation, the divided by the temperature at the time of nucleation. And you want this parameter to be order one or larger for the phase transition to be sufficiently out of equilibrium that you can have interesting cosmological effects. So that's the sort of range of interest where this parameter is or of order one or larger. So on the plot, on the y-axis, you have the CA parameter parameterizing the dimension 8 operator, and on the x-axis, you have this cutoff scale setting the dimension 6 operator. So if you would only, you would truncate the effective field theory at dimension 6, you set the CA parameter to 0, you're going along the red line in this plot here. And you see that you have indeed a phase transition that's first order for cutoff scales that sort of between 7,750 and 1,000 GeV. So this is pretty consistent with the estimate. And the second thing to observe is that if you then include the dimension 8 parameters, so you take C8 values that are non-zero, the strength of the phase transition actually changes because the equipotential lines of constant strength are not perfectly vertical. So it means that the dimension 8 parameter, if large enough, changes the exact the parameters describing the phase transition and the precision dynamics of the phase transition. And sort of based on this numerical results, you made an estimate that if you want to calculate, say, the strength of your phase transition to about a 10% accuracy, you want the C8 parameter absolute value to be smaller than order one. And note also that this accuracy constraint is stronger than the a constraint above where your expansion of the effective field theory is valid. So it may be that for accuracy, you have to include the CA8 parameter, the dimension 8 operator, but you can still have a valid EFT expansion, meaning that if you would also include the dimension 10 and 12, et cetera, higher order parameter operators, the effects of that are small, still small. Yeah, so this sort of completes the description of the phase transition within the EFT framework. Okay, let me then look at explicit UV completions that can give rise to first order phase transition and see if they actually can reproduce the parameter values in the EFT that we have just seen that you need for the first order phase transition. And let me start with UV completion that only give rise to loop level matching. So what I mean is that when you integrate out new physics, that the operators in the EFT are only generated via loop diagrams. And this happens when your Lagrangian starts at a quadratic level as given here. And so most of the extensions people consider in the literature consider extra scalars. So I will focus on this, but you can do the same analysis if your new degree of freedom is Cage boson, effective boson, or a fermion. And qualitatively, you get similar results as far as the question of separation of scales is concerned. So let me, for simplicity, focus on a scalar field, and also for now, just one single degree of freedom extra. So, well, one single scalar field can be more degrees of freedom depending on the representation or the of this scalar field. If it is a single, so the Lagrangian for the scalar field, the quadratic terms are then given by the Lagrangian above. And the d squared is the kinetic term, the m squared is the mass term for the scalar, and u parameterizes the coupling to the Higgs field. And on dimensional grounds and cage symmetry for a scalar, this is quadratic in the Higgs field. And for example, if the scalar would just be a singlet field, it would have the form given here on the right. So this Lagrangian doesn't have a linear term in the scalar field. And this you can get if you impose a set two symmetry on the scalar so that it transforms that the Lagrangian should be invariant if you set S to minus S. This forbids the linear term. In this case, then you get indeed that the EFT operators are generated by loop diagrams. And just to give the simple example, you can look at the diagram where S is running in the loop and you have three insertions of this U coupling to the X field. Then at low energies, this looks just like a dimension six X interactions. And of course, because you have the explicit UV theory, you can now calculate the cutoff scale and the Wilson coefficients and parameterizing this operator. So if you do this generically, you get the following results where I've written down the dimension six and the dimension eight operators. And you've got, you have of course the whole tower of higher order operators. And as I mentioned, I'm leaving out the subdominant derivative corrections. So now you can match these dimension six and eight terms to the terms that we had before in the EFT. And in particular, you can extract the lambda and C8 coupling introduced before. And then you can translate the requirement that we found to get a first order phase transition, what it means in terms of these parameters here. And this is done here at the bottom. And you see that this combination on the left has to be of the order one to get a first order phase transition. Now this first term, I forgot to mention, but CS parameterizes the decrease of freedom of this scalar field depending on the representation. So if for a real scalar, it would be just one, for a complex scalar two, a singlet scalar two. In any case, and kappa is the coupling to the X field. And you see that this first factor here, if you want your UV theory to be perturbative, so be able to calculate anything in the UV perturbatively, you want this first term, the kappa squared over four pi squared, to be much smaller than one. And the second requirement is, of course, that you want your EFT expansion to be valid. And if you look at the formula above, you see that the dimension eight term is small compared to the dimension six, if in addition U over M squared is much smaller than one. So both of these factors have to be much smaller than one. So this means you can never reach the requirement for a first order phase transition. So to get a perturbative UV theory, ultraviolet theory, and a valid EFT description, so enough separations of scales, the two requirements together tell you that if you have loop level matching, you never get a description in terms of an EFT that's valid and that can describe the dynamics of the phase transition. So let's then continue and look at UV completions with tree level matching. So this means that the operators in your effective field theory are now can now be generated by tree level diagrams. And this can happen when you also have a linear term in the Lagrangian. So the first term in the Lagrangian at the top of the slide. And here B parameterizes the coupling to the Higgs field of this linear term. You see that this linear terms, if you write down the equations of motion for the for this new scalar field, then it, from the equations of motion, you see that it gets, it's non-zero. So it not only the Higgs gets a FEV, but also the scalar field. Oh, sorry, the extra new heavy scalar field. And this means that you have mixing between the Higgs and the scalar, which is very constrained by the electroweak precision data. And especially, for example, if you look at the rho parameter here, the formula is given on the right-hand side of this plot. This you can calculate this in terms of the quantum numbers of the Higgs field and extra fields in your Higgs potential. So the T is the I-spin and hypercharge values, and then the V are the FEVs of the particular fields in the Higgs potential. Sorry. So the rho parameter is measured to be extremely close to one. So this means that if you just add general non-singlet fields to your Higgs potential, for example, a Higgs triplet, the correction to the rho parameter is large unless the triplet has a really large FEV, and really large meaning the scale of 10 TeV or larger. And as we've seen, this scale is too large to be interesting for the phase transition. So basically, the only option if you do three-level matching and you want a system with a first-order phase transition, you have to make sure that the new fields that you're adding, they for them, the top line in this rho parameter cancels. So you pick the quantum numbers of these fields appropriately. And if you do this, then you see that the option is a singlet with a zero quantum number. So it vanishes by definition. Another option is to add just another Higgs-like doublet. So a doublet with the same quantum numbers as the Higgs fields. And if you go to higher dimensional representations, you get to a seven plet and higher. So we haven't considered them. It turns out if you add a doublet field and you integrate it out, the dimension term, the Higgs term, is actually negative. So this doesn't work, because then if you want a stable minimum, it has to be stabilized by the dimension A term. And then automatically you don't have a separation of scales between the dimension 6 and 8 term. So the only thing left is the singlet option. So let's discuss in the last part of the talk. As I said, you can generate the operators in your EFT with three-level diagrams. And the diagram for the dimension 6 operator is, for example, this one, where you have one U insertion from the quadratic Lagrangian and two B insertion from the linear turns here. And then you get the expression below this diagram, and you can Taylor expand the propagator of the S in the diagram. And then the leading term at low energies is just a dimension 6 operator. So this is once again the results that you get, dimension 6, 8, and then the subdominant terms. And translating in the condition on the first order phase transition, you now get the expression at the bottom of the slide. And now the first term has to be smaller than 4 pi squared to be, for the UV theory to be perturbative. And this A parameter by dimensional analysis, the B, so it's on the right top of the slide, it comes from the coupling in the linear term to the X field. And secondly, for the EFT expansion to be valid, you want U over M squared to be smaller than one. And if you compare this to the one loop result, maybe the result is not so surprising, but you basically gain a loop factor, so a factor of 4 pi squared compared to the constraint that we had before. So now if you plug it in, sort of, it's marginally possible to have an EFT description. And since this is orders of magnitude, we decided also to do the numerics for this to see whether our estimates are indeed correct. And then you get the results over here, where once again, this is the parameterizing the strength of the phase transition is the color coding. The plot on the right is the plot that we saw before in the EFT. And on the left is the plot for the singlet model. So the where the phase transition has been calculated in the UV complete model. And the parameters on the axis are the singlet mass and the singlet VEF. And so we know we have a one-to-one matching between the singlet parameters in the UV complete model and in the EFT matching. So you can, so what then the, so the lines, for example, on the left plot, the corresponding lines, if you translate the parameters, are the red and line, the red and green lines in the right plot and vice versa. So you can translate back and forth. And so the main point is the green line, because the bottom green line is where the dimension 8 parameters is half, yeah, well, it's written here on the right, where the dimension 8 time, the dimension 8 operator is half times the dimension 6 operator at the relevant square scale, whereas the dashed line, it's more conservative, so the EFT expansion should be better. It's 0.3. And so you see that in the singlet model, you only have a chance of an EFT description for singlet masses, say, larger than 800 GeV. And the other thing is the red lines are the lines where you have constant strength in the singlet model. And if you translate it to the right plot, you see that in the EFD description, the lines are not completely constant, not even in the region where you would expect the EFD description to be reasonably valid. But this is probably more because when we did the matching, we did it only at one loop, at three levels. So if you include do the matching at loop level, you would probably get better consistency. We definitely checked that if you add dimension, for example, the dimension 10 term, that the in that region above the dashed green line, the effects are small. So I think that's just a matching issue. And then finally, to come back to the earlier question, on the right-hand side plot, you have the purple and the red lines. And the red line is if we include the derivative terms in the effective field theory, the dimension 6 derivative operators, whereas the purple is if we turn them off and never consider them. And you see that they give similar results in the region where you have some hope of that the EFT gives a good description. But if you go below the green solid line, where the EFT description breaks down fully, it's only there that this dimension as this derivative operators become important. So this at least numerically shows this effect. This is for, yeah, given the time, I think these plots are showing similar results for different parameters. So this sort of, let me then go to the conclusion. So as I said in the main part of the talk, it's interesting if the electrophilic phase transition would be first order, because then we can not only probe it in an accelerator, but also possibly by cosmological probes, so as gravitational waves, weird genesis, and large scale magnetic fields. But this requires new physics beyond the standard model. And it would be great if this could be described in some framework that's to some extent model independent. But as we've seen, there's not a large enough separation of scales. And the EFT description is not useful, and not useful is here a severe understatement, because as we saw, loop level matching never works, and tree level you have only a singlet extension and only in part of parameter space that it is a good description. So by all means, it's much more useful to just work with the full theory than with the EFT description. Of course, we only looked at UV completion with a single degree of freedom. But in general, adding more fields doesn't necessarily improve things, because yes, your effects, it's much easier to get a phase transition so that you win. But at the same time, you also, the theory becomes much sooner non-perturbative so that you lose. So, for example, if you just add n copies of the same scalar fields with no self-interactions between the scalars, definitely the situation doesn't improve. And as a final remark, we did this for the electroweak phase transition, this conditions to derive when the EFT description is valid, but you can also generalize it to dark sector phase transition. And you have more freedom, because the X mass and the dark X coupling mass and FEV have not been measured. So in recent years, there has been quite a few papers analyzing gravitational waves in dark sector phase transition. So then our results provide an easy check in this setup whether the in EFT description is useful in the parameter space there under consideration or not. And on that note, let me finish here.